Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. We're doing a series of lessons on the Sabbath school materials prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church for the second quarter of 2013. It's a series entitled Major Lessons from Minor Prophets. And there's some very interesting material in here, at least I think so. This particular lesson is lesson number 4 for April 27 of 2013. It's entitled Lord of All Nations, and it's the first 4 chapters of Amos and the 1 chapter of Obadiah put together. So get your Bible ready, and while you're grabbing it, we're going to ask you to bow your head with us, and let's have a word of prayer. Our kind and loving Father, we know how much effort went into preserving these records from so long ago and in the form that we have them, readable and understandable as they are in our Bibles. May we now gather the information that you want us to know and to understand from these 2 short books is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amos describes himself as a herdsman. The term actually means a sheep breeder and a tender of sycamore fruit. So let's talk a little bit about that. I mean, if you said someone was a herder and a tender of sycamore fruit, would that describe to you someone who might be a General Conference president? Doesn't sound like it, does it? Mm-hmm. This guy is an ordinary Joe Blow, okay? He's a very common person. He comes from the southern kingdom of Judah, but God calls him to leave his sheep and go up to the northern kingdom of Israel and preach a message to them because they are about to be taken into Assyrian captivity and scattered to the winds. So this is an end-time message for the nation of Israel. So the sycamore fig tree, to understand a little bit more about Amos, was a large tree, but the figs were generally of an inferior type. Their quality was greatly enhanced if each fig was pinched or slit on the upper part of the fruit, or possibly at the very bottom of the fruit, before it matured. The resulting fruit became sweeter and softer. The climate of Tekoa is the town of where Amos came from, was not conducive to sycamore figs, so Amos most likely performed this part of his work in another part of the region. His book does not tell us whether he owned his own flocks and fig orchards or whether he labored as a hired hand for others. Whatever the case, he was itinerant. Both his sheep herding and fig slitting took him to different places. Undoubtedly, the observations he made as he traveled informed and fueled his comments on Israel's situation before God. It's taken from a book entitled The Abundant Life Bible Amplifier on Amos. Tekoa was located about 10 to 12 miles directly south of Jerusalem, about 5 or 6 miles southeast of Bethlehem. And when did Amos work? Well, Uzziah was king over Judah from 767 BC to 750 BC. And Jeroboam was over Israel from 782 to 753 BC. Therefore, we conclude, because he said his ministry was during the time of those 2 kings, we might conclude that the ministry of Amos took place sometime between the years 767 and 753 BC. Nothing is currently known about the great earthquake he mentions in Amos 1:1, except that 250 years later they were still talking about it in Zechariah 14:5. Virtually nothing is known about the prophet Obadiah. He probably lived at the time of the Babylonian exile during one or more of the conquests of Judah by Nebuchadnezzar. Both Amos and Obadiah came from the country of Judah, but each prophesied against other nations primarily. Amos traveled north and prophesied against the country of Israel, while Obadiah prophesied against the country of Edom. Both prophets prophesied against groups of people who felt quite satisfied with their present condition.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
When you say they prophesied against, mm-hmm. Are you meaning that they told off these people?
They tried
to correct these people?
As far as possible.
So that's what it means when you say prophesized against.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. They apparently saw nothing wrong with these groups of people they are prophesying to, apparently saw nothing wrong with abusing other people for their own advantage. And neither group paid virtually any attention to the true God. So, Amos starts out his book by prophesying against the nations surrounding Israel. He started with Syria in the north, moves to Philistia in the southwest, then to Tyre in the northwest, I'm getting my hands backwards here, to Edom in the southeast, to Ammon and Moab in the east, to Judah in the south, and then goes to work on Israel as his main target.
I have another question.
Yes.
These people that he's prophesying against that live in all these places, are they Jewish people?
No.
Well,
except Judah and Israel.
So he's going to the Gentiles mm-hmm. and saying, you're not worshiping the true God. Is that kind of an evangelist? Why does God send him to the Gentiles?
What he's doing here is he's specifically saying, what you're doing are basically crimes against humanity. And he goes around and around. And then he's going to end up saying, Israel, and you're supposed to know better, and you're doing the same thing.
So it must have been a terrible society mm-hmm. in people's treatment of one another.
Mm-hmm. And Amos is particularly hard on the rich.
And we made the point at the beginning that it was his travels, going to different places with his herds, that gave him opportunity to look at these various conditions and come to his conclusions.
Yeah. And one more bit of history. I'm sorry, we're taking a little bit of time here. The history of Israel, the northern kingdom. Remember, after Solomon, the nation was divided. There was a northern kingdom of Israel. There was a southern kingdom of Judah. The history of that northern kingdom of Israel is dark. Not one of the 20 kings in the northern kingdom followed God. All of the kings, from the first by the name of Jeroboam to the last by the name of Hoshea, were wicked. They did things that were wrong in the sight of the Lord. There was not a single exception, only plots and revolts and exploitation, violence, terror, corruption, tragedy, and desperation prevailed. Just to illustrate, 7 of Israel's kings were assassinated, 1 committed suicide, and 1 was stricken by God. How would you like to be ruled by a group of people like that? Bible uses King Ahab and his wife Jezebel is a symbol of the evil in Israel. Not one was a God-fearing ruler. None repented or undertook reformation. They led the people to destruction. They were leaders of doom. What an unfortunate and evil situation. No wonder God needed to send strong medicine to shake the stubborn nation and stop the prevailing wickedness. But unfortunately, as we know from history, not even the voice of a prophet helped.
You know, it says here in this book that Israel's 2 primary sins were an absence of true worship and a lack of justice. They're not following God's standard of justice with their neighbors.
Sure.
So they were not treating each other good. Now, if this community repented like Nineveh did, this community did not repent. Nineveh repented and God did not follow through with what was going to happen.
That's correct.
We're facing a people here who do not repent, right? They're mm-hmm. Stubborn and...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So now if if Amos goes to these other countries and he comes back to Israel, does he tell, does Israel hear what from these other countries, what Amos is, how do they... I mean, he's going to come back to Israel and say, now look, you know, you're not any better. Mm-hmm. Does he come back and tell them what he has done? Or do they hear that
fair question.
Kind of like Jonah, you know, the people had heard the story of Jonah before he got there. Mm-hmm. When Amos comes back to Israel, have stories gotten back to what he's saying to these other people?
Well, that's a little hard to tell from the book. It is interesting to notice this. As near as we can tell from prophecy, and there's pretty good evidence for this because Amos actually gives us dates, or tells us the times of the kings anyway, Amos was the very first prophet to actually write out his message.
Hmm.
The very first. So he sets a very important precedent for us because, I mean, think of Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel and so forth. Amos was the first one to write out his message. So that's important, at least it sounds like it to me.
Well, that confuses me.
Okay.
So how did Daniel's message get written out?
Later. Amos was the first one. So remember, these are not in chronological order.
Okay.
Oh, Amos is before...
Amos is before Isaiah, before Daniel, before Ezekiel, before Jeremiah, before any of those other books. Amos is the first one, chronologically.
So is Joel's written out?
His message, we don't have Joel's message. It just says, the day of the Lord is coming. That's basically his message.
Oh, I see.
I mean, we assume he said more things, but it's not written out. Amos spells out quite a bit of detail what his message was. So he's the first person to actually write out in some detail his actual message. That's the point.
Is this Amos is not the Amos with the Z?
No.
Okay, I wanted to make sure.
No.
So we're speaking of an educated person here who knew how to write and had resources to get writing materials, which was very expensive in those days.
Yes. I'm a little confused.
Okay.
Wasn't Moses a prophet? Didn't he write an awful lot before this?
Yes, but he doesn't write as a prophet like the prophets write. I mean, he wrote a lot of books, but basically his books are historical.
Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, you could say some of his material is prophetic, but he isn't. We don't think of him as the first prophet.
Okay. So is Amos instead of going right out to the people and telling them his message, you're saying that he's writing it down, maybe
he
first.
He did both,
and
we don't know whether he wrote it first or whether he preached it first. But at least he wrote, he preached it, and he did write it down.
So can we date this relative to the young and old prophet in Kings, that story?
Yes, the young and old prophet in the book of Kings would be prior to Amos. Yeah, because that was during the days of the first king of the northern country of Israel, that Jeroboam. So that's before Amos, yes.
You know what's interesting? I'm starting to read Amos. And he's saying, he begins his paragraphs, I guess you would call them, thus saith the Lord, thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord. So he thought, he was being given messages, and
exactly.
He said, the Lord is saying this.
Yeah.
Listen to the Lord, the Malach Yahweh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's pretty typical of a prophet, isn't it?
Yeah. So here's the challenge of Amos that we're going to spend more time on. What is the relationship between our spiritual condition, that is our relationship to God, and our ethical treatment of those around us, our neighbors? In times of prosperity, social injustice sometimes becomes even worse. What we're going to see in these nations around Israel and in Israel, and the thing that Amos decries is the rich are taking advantage of the poor in every way they possibly can. So, what is the relationship between our spiritual condition and our treatment of others?
Total and complete relationship.
Total and complete relationship. Why do you say that?
If we are true to, we can say that, we could go to church and say we're Christians, and go home and beat our maid or treat other people bad. But I mean, to be truly incoherent with yourself, you cannot be a follower of God's and treat anyone other than Jesus would treat them.
You mean our religion needs to affect every day of the week and not just Saturday?
Yes.
Dennis.
The last six commandments of the Ten Commandments deals with our relationship with each other. And if it doesn't apply to our neighbors, if we don't apply it to our neighbors, are we not misbehaving? Are we not violating God's?
That was Amos's message, I'm sorry. Isaiah, some years later, about Isaiah probably spoke prophesied about 30 years after Amos, wrote these words in Isaiah 58. The Lord says, shout as loud as you can. Tell my people Israel about their sins. They worship me every day, claiming that they are eager to know my ways and obey my laws. They say they want me to give them just laws and that they take pleasure in worshiping me. The people ask, why should we fast if the Lord never notices? Why should we go without food if he pays no attention? The Lord says to them, the truth is that at the same time as you fast, you pursue your own interests and oppress your workers. Your fasting makes you violent and you quarrel and fight. Do you think this kind of fasting will make me listen to your prayers? When you fast, you make yourselves suffer. You bow your heads low like a blade of grass and spread out sackcloth and ashes to lie on. Is that what you're calling fasting? Do you think I would be pleased with that? The kind of fasting I want is this. Remove the chains of oppression and the yoke of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Share your food with the hungry and open your homes to the homeless poor. Give clothes to those who have nothing to wear and do not refuse to help your own relatives. Then my favor will shine on you like the morning sun and your wounds will be quickly healed. I will always be with you to save you. My presence will protect you on every side. When you pray, I will answer you. When you call to me, I will respond. If you put an end to oppression, to every gesture of contempt and to every evil word, if you give food to the hungry and satisfy those who are in need, then the darkness around you will turn to the brightness of noon, and he goes on. But that's a good start anyway.
Wow. You know, go ahead.
That's certainly cogent for modern times, isn't it?
You think so?
I do.
The only thing, it's getting confusing because there are people that don't want to work and they will always want you to feed them. Mm-hmm. Then there are people that really need to be fed. It's just so confusing. I guess you have to use your God-given judgment in trying to sort it out today.
I think they didn't have organizations for benevolence. This kind of benevolence was person to person. You found somebody, they came to you, you develop a relationship, you give, they receive, then time comes, they have opportunity to thank, and you have it. We have a system where we kind of put it off in some department of government.
Impersonal.
And it's very impersonal. And those kinds of things that you're talking about, I think, develop because of that impersonal implementation of supposed benevolence.
In Scripture, and let me speak here pretty bluntly, in Scripture, it is God's plan that the poor should be cared for by individuals, first of all, members of their own family if possible, or by their local church. And the local church could include almost a commune kind of setting as what's happened in the early years of the Christian church, there when everybody was coming together and they were all eating together and so forth like that. Or it could be something a little bit different than that. But that is what God says is the way for poor people to be taken care of. There's none of this impersonal government organizations, that kind of stuff. That was never God's plan.
I believe Jay mentioned before when we were speaking about Joel, that it's all about works. But what looks like works doesn't appeal to God sometimes, because the intent of the person, because someone may do all the movement and what have you, but if the intent is not pure, that's not what God wants. For example, I see someone in the street, they're asking me for money. I don't know what they're going to do with the money, but I leave it to God because I know this person has to eat. And I'm hoping that he takes the money and goes and eats with it. But if he does something else with it, that's not my judgment. I just do what I can and I move on. Mm.
I have a friend who often helps people. And he very often helps people who are asking for money in parking lots outside
of the
grocery stores. And he says, okay, this is what he does. He says, okay, what kind of food do you like? Okay, okay, fine. You wait here a few minutes. He goes in, he does his shopping, he buys stuff for the man, he comes out and gives him a bag full of groceries.
I did something similar to that and got a frown.
Well,
I know somebody that they have taken and bought a gift card for a few bucks to a particular restaurant, and then when they come to one of those, they give them that, and at least they're not spending it on drugs then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I did that to a local restaurant, and I remember there was a fella waiting in the off-ramp or mm-hmm. something, and I remember handing him that card, and he just said, great. You know, it was a $5 mm-hmm. gift card.
But you know, what this also says, which is hard, is to work with your own family, help your own family. Mm-hmm. And the other thought just left me.
Well, let's come back to our study guide. By the way, if you're interested in these materials, we mention this on a regular basis, you can find these very handouts we use under the Sabbath School section in our website, theox.org, theox.org.
The other thought just came to me.
Okay.
You're supposed to treat those who work for you
mm-hmm.
with dignity and fairness.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to notice that we find some very familiar words found in Leviticus 19:18, for example, do not take revenge on anyone or continue to hate him, but love your neighbor as you love yourself. I thought that was a New Testament idea. And then I turned to Deuteronomy 6, verse 5, where it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. I think somebody important quoted that, didn't they?
Yes.
That Jesus was not coming up with that de novo, that's straight out of the Old Testament. And by the way, there are lots of verses starting from, let me show you Exodus 22, starting with 21 to 24, about the treatment specifically of widows and orphans. Do not ill-treat or oppress a foreigner. Remember that you were foreigners in Egypt. Do not ill-treat any widow or orphan. If you do, I, the Lord, will answer them when they cry out to me for help, and I will be angry and kill you in war. Your wives will become widows and your children will be fatherless. Does that sound like God is taking an active role here? Well, look all the way down in the New Testament, James 2, verses 14 and following. My brothers and sisters, what good is it for people to say that they have faith if their actions do not prove it? Can that faith save them? Suppose there are brothers or sisters who need clothes and don't have enough food to eat. Remember my comment a moment ago that the local church is supposed to be taking care of people? Here it is. What good is there in you saying to them, God bless you, keep warm, eat well, if you don't give them the necessities of life? So it is with faith. If it is alone and includes no actions, then it is dead.
Are you saying that the New Covenant is in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament, and the Old Covenant is also in the Old Testament, and it's also mentioned in the New Testament?
Maybe that's why Revelation calls it the everlasting gospel.
Okay, so it's the everlasting covenant.
Oh, I'm sorry. Right. Jay, does this sound like works to you?
Well, the reason I bring that up is we hear so much about faith today, mm-hmm. and we hear very little about works. And I usually bring that up as kind of a contrast to get some kind of a balance and an understanding there. I mean, it seems like when we discussed Joel in our last session, and as we look at this and the Old Testament, there is a lot of, if you do this, you're going to be blessed, and if you don't, you're going to be cursed. Okay. And I guess today you don't hear anything like that. It's all faith, and somehow faith, it's just all going to flow out. And we don't hear anything about discipline, self-control, the power of the will. And I happen to think those are kind of all extensions of a faith.
Yeah. That result in action that
right.
you could define as works.
Yeah, that's right. Your
exactly.
Your faith and grace. You know, we hear so much that it seems like there's plenty of grace for the sins you've committed. There's
yeah.
plenty of power to take care of the sins you've committed. But now that those are all taken care of, You know, you've asked your forgiveness and you've repented. Now you move on.
How about tomorrow?
That's right. And we never hear anything about about that. And so I guess that's why I raise so much about works and so forth, to kind of get some clarity there. And
in these first four chapters of Amos, the first two chapters have focused on pointing out the problems in the nations around. Then in chapter 3, he says something interesting. People of Israel, listen to this message which the Lord has spoken about you. Now remember, this is the farmer showing up at the capital city, raising these condemning words, okay? The entire Lord has spoken about you, the entire nation that he brought out of Egypt. Of all the nations on earth, you are the only one I have known and cared for. That is what makes your sins so terrible, and that is why I must punish you for them. He's just spoken about all God's comments about all these other nations, and all of a sudden he says, you're the only one I've known and cared for? What does that mean?
It seems to me that it's a matter of emphasis, because he has cared for so many nations. It's just that he holds this one out. This is the one to whom he sends his prophets. He's the one who he has pulled out of Egypt. He's the one that he spent 40 years visibly, day in, day out, night in, night out. His presence was there. That he has had his hand very visibly on them.
Yes.
But hasn't he had his hand as visibly on the Ammonites and the Edomites and they don't have, I guess, he's expecting the Jews, the Hebrews, the Israelites with this extra bit of information that he's given them to minister to those people, but certainly he's trying to get through to the Edomites with, you know, there's other things besides scripture that speak to people. The Holy Spirit is there pricking their conscience as well.
The Hebrew word here that means, that's translated to know, is yada. It implies an intimate friendship and not just a casual knowledge. Can I give some illustrations? Look at Genesis 4, verse 1. And, of course, it's spoiled when you read my Good News translation, because they don't want you to miss the meaning here. Then Adam had intercourse with his wife, and she became pregnant. The King James says, the word is, Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she became pregnant. Okay? That's the kind of knowing we're talking about. But look at the opposite as well. By contrast, at the time of the judgment, what is Jesus going to say to some people? Look at Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Not everyone who calls me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do what my Father in heaven wants them to do. When judgment day comes, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, in your name we spoke God's message. By your name we drove out many demons and performed many miracles. I mean, if one of us showed up on one of these TV programs and said, I can swear to you, I drove out demons, I performed miracles, we would say, wow, wouldn't we? Then I will say to them, Jesus goes on, I never knew you. Get away from me, you wicked people.
And Jesus' last prayer, at least before he died, his eternal life is to know the Father and the Son.
So
this is not just a casual, oh yeah, I guess you're up there maybe.
So here are two groups of people claiming to know Jesus, to know God. To one group he says, well done, good and faithful servant. To the other group he says, I never knew you. How do we know, as we claim to know Jesus, that he knows us? Because that seems to be the most important part here.
Yeah.
Well, and to follow that up a little bit, when Jesus was here, the disciples got a little upset because there were some people who were not part of their little group going around casting out demons and doing other things, and Jesus said that they were doing a good work, leave them alone, and so on. So, yeah, to follow up on Norm's, how do you, I mean, yeah. Were they, you know, were they, I don't know, they were doing things they weren't supposed to be doing, and when they show up at the gate and said, you know, we did these things, it, well, no, Jesus, it looked to me like Jesus was affirming those people.
There's a very interesting contrast of that found in the book of Acts, I think it's chapter 17 or 18 right in there, when Paul was in Ephesus working with the people there, and a certain gentleman had seven sons, the seven sons of Sceva, and they saw what Paul was doing, and they heard him casting out demons and doing other things in the name of Jesus, and they thought, this name of Jesus must have some power in it. Let's see what we can do. So they came to this, this demon-possessed guy, and they said, in the name of Jesus, come out. And this demon-possessed guy beat them up and really tore them to pieces, and he says, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? So you can't misuse this information. This isn't some magical trick here. We're talking about a real knowing of Jesus. Because Paul could use Jesus' name and cast out people, cast out demons and the demons.
So these group, these few guys that the disciples were concerned about, you get the impression that, I don't know, were these that had followed Jesus a long time?
Probably.
Maybe even John the Baptist, and then followed Jesus. So
well,
maybe we don't know their names or don't know too much.
Probably not so well known.
Right, yeah, but...
But they might well come up to the gate, and Jesus said, well done, thou good and faithful servant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's...
We're not told which group they would be in.
Right, but that, I would assume that.
Yeah.
But I was just, to follow up on your... You know, how do you know which... I mean, if you're casting out demons...
Yeah.
How do you know? I mean, I would think, hey, I'm on the right road here.
How do I know that Jesus knows me?
Yeah.
Is the question.
Well, here, let me get very specific now, in following Amos's cue. It's a terrible temptation for people who are doing fairly well and consider themselves even wealthy to relax and sit back and forget or ignore their responsibilities to God and their neighbors. Does that sound a little bit like maybe Laodicea? Remember Revelation 3, verses 14 to 22?
Well, yes. It doesn't say that they're blind, naked, miserable, and wretched. as bad as Laodicea.
Okay, but hold on. These people are about to be destroyed.
Yeah.
God's about to give up on them permanently. But what did they think? They thought they were wealthy. And what did the Laodiceans think? Well,
rich
let me read
and increase
this.
With good.
To the angel of the church of Laodicea write, this is the message from the Amen, the faithful and true witness, who is the origin of all that God has created. I know what you have done. I know that you are neither cold nor hot. How I wish you were either one or the other. I mean, I would rather have you be cold. But because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. You say, here we go, Norm.
Yeah.
I am rich and well off. I have all I need. But you do not know how miserable and pitiful you are. You are poor, naked, and blind. I advise you then to buy gold from me, pure gold, in order to be rich. Buy also white clothing to dress yourself and cover up your shameful nakedness. Buy also some ointment to put on your eyes so that you may see. I rebuke and punish all whom I love. Be in earnest then and turn from your sins. Listen, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with them, and they will eat with me. To those who win the victory, I will give the right to sit beside me on my throne, just as I have been victorious and now sit by my Father on his throne.
Unbelievable promise.
Isn't that incredible?
We had an absolute fascinating lecture from Neil Nedley last Sabbath, and it talked about character development, and that's what is missing. And in God's people, he went into emotional intelligence. The biggest predictor of their spiritual health and your life success is the character trait of self-control, mm-hmm. which is beginning to be a lost art in today's world. And it has no downside. It's being studied even by outside psychologists. And at Weimar, they're starting a study of what steps are needed to learn self-control. I mean, we are so far away from true character development, that we have to go back to the basics and start learning, how do we learn self-control? Isn't that amazing? So Laodicea, no self-control.
Mm-hmm. Is it possible that God has blessed Adventists too much?
No, but it makes a horrible responsibility that they're stuck with.
I mean, which group can you name in the entire history of our world that has more spiritual information, more spiritual light, that has more, I mean, the teachings of more gospel writers, more prophets and so forth?
Absolutely,
I mean,
none.
Nobody else is even close to what we have. And what are we doing with all that? Well, there's a verse that Jesus gave, a couple of verses, that might give us some thought, something to think about. They're found in Luke 12, verses 47 and 48. The servant who knows what his master wants him to do, but does not get himself ready to do it, will be punished with a heavy whipping. But the servant who does not know what his master wants, and yet does something for which he deserves a whipping, will be punished with a light whipping. Much is required from the person whom much is given. Much more is required from the person whom much more is given. And how much have we been given?
Well, to follow that up a little bit, we have lots of stuff. I think we have an understanding of just the simple biblical story that many people do not.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the tremendous materials that Ellen White's left.
Yes.
And we've got all those books in the Bible. And we have programs like this. We've got all this stuff. And I can't handle it all. There was a time when I felt I needed to know it all. I needed to read it all. And reflect it all. And correct me if I'm drawing the wrong conclusion here, but I've kind of come to the conclusion that there's something I'm going to call the daily bread. And you don't have to know it all. You just have to do with what you've got today. And am I making sense here, or?
Well,
sort of.
Let me help you with some words from Ellen White. This is found in Christ Obsolescence, page 317. The professed churches of Christ in this generation are exalted to the highest privileges. The Lord has been revealed to us in ever-increasing light. Our privileges are far greater than were the privileges of God's ancient people.
Well, you know, sometimes, and from the outside, because just coming to the Adventist church, I think that sometimes Adventists are embarrassed about the knowledge, maybe embarrassed about God's ways and God, and it doesn't fit with the culture, and they want to be with the culture, but they want to be with God. But God, doesn't God just separate and say, either you're one way or the other? There seems to be some people don't like all the information we've been given, and it seems they're embarrassed about things, maybe like the sanctuary or something like that. And I'd
like to comment.
That's what I've picked up on.
I'd like to comment on Jay's question. It seems to me that we ought to have an attitude where we want to know it all and work to that end and realize that we don't know it all.
Mm-hmm.
In that tension, and we live in that tension.
My perspective, eventually, I just happened to think of this as a follow-up thought, is God has not put in my cup just what I need. My cup is overflowing.
Yes.
And I can even kind of pick mm-hmm. some of what I want to do, and so forth.
Yeah.
My cup just absolutely overflows.
Yeah. All through history, God has called people not to just to special privilege, everybody wants the privileges, but to great responsibility. The Seventh-day Adventist Church in our day has experienced more spiritual privileges than any generation before. Are we living up to our responsibilities? After speaking about the abuses against humanity right throughout Palestine, Amos focuses on the nation of Israel and says, prepare to meet your God, O Israel. How would we respond if a guy who looked like an old farmer showed up at church one Sabbath and says, prepare to meet your God?
Didn't that Miller guy, wasn't he a farmer, mm-hmm. and he did that?
And just almost exactly like that.
Mm-hmm. Call security.
Yeah, call he security.
He was accepted by some and rejected by many.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure there were people, although it's not recorded, I bet there were people who called security on Amos, too.
Yeah, probably. Well, they told him. They said, go home. We don't need you up here. Yeah. Well, how's God going to punish those who've experienced such great privilege and aren't carrying their responsibilities? Amos mentions seven specific disasters that God is going to send. Famine, drought, scorching winds, locusts, plagues, war, and a destruction like that of Sodom and Gomorrah, who are now buried under the Dead Sea. How much were the children of Israel supposed to respond? How were the children of Israel supposed to respond to such events?
Well, but don't we all have doesn't every nation have some of that? Doesn't every individual have its own kind of famines from time to time, and its own kind of, you know, isn't every day of life a little bit of the life, a bit of that? And maybe I'm confessing things here. Maybe my life is like that, and it shouldn't be because, yeah. You know, maybe if I was what I ought to be, I wouldn't have.
Were they told what they were supposed to do in response to this kind of plague, for example? Listen to these words from Solomon. This is in the middle of his prayer at the dedication of that fantastic temple there in Jerusalem. Okay? When there is famine in the land, or an epidemic, or the crops are destroyed by scorching winds or swarms of locusts, does that sound like what we just read? Or when your people are attacked by their enemies, or when there is disease or sickness among them, then what's supposed to happen? Listen to their prayers. He's praying to God. Listen to their prayers. If any of you people of your people Israel, out of heartfelt sorrow, stretch out their hands in prayers toward this temple. Hear their prayer. Listen to them in your home in heaven. Forgive them and help them. You alone know the thoughts of the human heart. Deal with each person as he deserves.
I'm thinking of the days of Elijah on Mount Carmel.
Yeah.
There was no reaching out to the temple. If they had the whole scenario would have changed.
Yeah.
So we get into a position where we're not reaching out, we're doing our own thing.
Weren't there some, though? Weren't there some in Israel?
7,000, he was told a little later.
You know, when Jesus came, it was a terrible time, but there was Zechariah, there was Joseph, there was Mary, there was lots of people. How many do you need?
Lots is a relative term.
Do you take comfort in thinking that you might be the Zechariah? Or do you think we'd be better off to say, hey, we've been described as Laodicea, and we have no right to think we're other than Laodicea?
Well, but there's got to be some of us that aren't Laodicean. How do you, you know, what is the percentage point that, you know?
I like the people of Nineveh that said, oh dear, and didn't they completely change?
They did. Yeah.
I mean, they had it in them.
You're getting ahead of us. That's Jonah coming up.
Oh, okay. Well, I admire those people.
That's right.
Well, how would the Adventist church, even our local congregation, and we ourselves respond if God said to us, I'm going to punish you, and because I'm going to do this, get ready to face my judgment? I mean, be honest now. Aren't we about to face the greatest time of God's judgment in the history of the great controversy?
Absolutely.
Does meeting God scare you? Should it? How has God treated sinners? Let's just assume for right now that we're all terrible sinners. How has God treated sinners right down through Scripture. What will God be doing while sinners are perishing at the end? He's going to be weeping.
He's always lamenting. Mm-hmm. Oh, Jerusalem. Oh, you know, he's always sad.
In the book, The Story of Redemption, page 29, it talks about the time shortly after Satan and his angels were thrown out of heaven. And Satan and his angels realized that they got themselves in a really bad situation. And they ask an angel if Christ would be willing to come and have an interview with them. And Christ comes out of the holy city and speaks to Satan, and Satan is weeping. Please, we want to come back. And all Satan's angels are weeping. Please, we want to come back. And Christ weeps with them. Does he know that they're eternally lost?
Yes.
He knows that. And what's his response to all of that? He weeps. Does that give us a clue about how God will respond when the wicked perish in the end?
Does God know, Jesus knew, that sin does something to you, that Satan and the angels had gone past the point of no return. Yeah. Even God himself could not repair the sin in him. And so that is what's so dangerous about letting sin in us.
Yeah. It's not God that we need to be afraid of, but sin. Remember Romans 6:23? Just a reminder. For sin pays its wage, death. But God's free gift is eternal life in union with Christ Jesus our Lord. Yes.
We sat through an interesting conference a week ago. And in that conference, they were talking about how diet changes your genetics mm-hmm. by what you eat, by what you do. The actual genes are turned off and turned on.
Epigenetics
was the topic, and I don't know where to go with that, but it seems like it's opening up a whole new thought process that might explain this idea of sin changing you.
Yeah. Well, you have too much pizza and beer, and you just let sin come into you easier than maybe if you have water and vegetables. I don't know. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it could actually change.
It has to do with the methylation of your actual genome.
Oh, and that was at the nutrition conference?
Mm-hmm. Well, but there's also an element of redemption in that. Mm-hmm. I think the best example is, alcoholism. We know now that some of that can be genetic. A disposition toward alcoholism can be. But so, I mean, if you weren't an alcoholic, but you became one, and then you pass those on to your youngsters, and then to their grandchildren, and so forth, how does that ever get corrected? Mm-hmm. And how that can get corrected is you change your behavior so that you don't do that as much, or you avoid it, and then that begins to change your genes. Mm-hmm. So that your children are not as subject as you were.
Now be careful here. People, your genetic friends are going to get all excited. Let's be clear what Norm's saying and what you're saying. What happens is not that the genes are actually changed. What happens is that they can be turned on and off in their function. It's the phenotype, the expression that actually changes. It's not the genetic code that changes. Okay. Let's be clear about that. Okay. In other words, the power to make proteins is on those genes. But they don't all function, and they aren't all functioning, making their given protein at any one time. They're little switches, and they can be turned on and they can be turned off.
But if my good gene is turned off, I'm in mm-hmm. trouble.
Yes.
You want to turn it on.
But I want some way to get it turned back on.
But they are ever-present.
Ever-present.
And the switches mm-hmm. can be flipped.
Yes, yeah. Okay. That's what we're talking about.
But what about the genetic disposition?
Well,
that's the mechanism of genetic disposition is the ones that are turned on and turned off.
We need to go ahead. Were you going to comment?
Yeah, it stands to reason if you grow up in a family where your father's drinking, there's alcohol around, and children want to mimic what they see. Mm-hmm. But if you stop that And hopefully, you know, it reverses. The your children will not do what my children have never seen a cigarette in my house, never seen a beer in my house. And my daughter, when she turns 18, she went to see her father. The first thing he did is try to give her a beer.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
Yeah. Well, we need to say a few words about the book of Obadiah. That's a part of our lesson as well. The nation of Edom had established itself in a very rocky and mountainous area east of the Dead Sea. Their capital city, known as Petra, is located at the end of a very narrow passage to a steep canyon, which would be easily defended in ancient times against any invading army. Edom was the nation of Esau's descendants, and they had had an ongoing battle with their cousins, the Israelites, down through the centuries. Obadiah begins by pointing out their arrogance in verses 1 to 4, prophesies the coming humiliation, verses 5 to 9, and then condemns them for their violence against Judah at a time of terrible distress for the Israelites in verses 10 to 14.
Now, is the people of Edom, they are not Jewish? Edom? Are they Jewish?
No. They are descendants. Remember, the Jewish people came from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to Judah and then his descendants. That's where Judah is where the name Jew comes from.
Okay.
Okay. These people come from Abraham, Isaac, and then Esau, the twin brother. Remember, Esau and Jacob were twin brothers.
Okay.
This is from the other twin, and this is the line that came from him. And he married Canaanite wives, and this is what happened.
And they were not worshiping God at all. They were had their own different kinds of religions.
Yes.
Okay.
May I?
Yeah.
We skip Amos 4.
Yes, we're going to talk more about Amos 4.
Okay. I like Amos 4.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Well, assuming we'll have time here. We will. Obadiah talks about them, and he talks about the destruction that's coming for them, and he says in verse 15, Edom, you will get back what you have given. Does that sound like the golden rule?
What would happen if we got all back what we had given?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that Obadiah 16, in some versions, continues by saying, those who act in that way will become as if they had never existed. And Adventists and others who believe in the non-immortality of the soul have used that verse as an evidence of eternal destruction, eternal complete non-existence. And here's a comment about that whole thing from Abraham Joshua Heschel, a very famous modern Jewish scholar. He says, from the beginnings of Israelite religion, the belief that God had chosen this particular people to carry out his mission has been both a cornerstone of Hebrew faith and a refuge in moments of distress. And yet, the prophets felt that to many of their contemporaries, this cornerstone was a stumbling block, this refuge and escape. They had to remind the people that chosenness, notice that interesting word, chosenness, must not be mistaken as divine favoritism or immunity from chastisement, but on the contrary, that it meant being more seriously exposed to divine judgment and chastisement. If you're given greater responsibility, what does God expect from you? I mean, if you're getting greater privilege, what does God expect? Greater responsibility. Does chosenness mean that God is exclusively concerned with Israel? Does the Exodus from Egypt imply that God is involved only in the history of Israel and is totally oblivious of the fate of other nations?
Weren't the people in Israel supposed to talk to other nations and evangelize?
They were put in this at the center of the world of their day, and the whole point was they were supposed to spread the gospel from Egypt to Mesopotamia.
Isn't Loma Linda in the crossroads of the freeways?
Just about. Well, you know, as we're coming to the end of our time, don't we think we're God's chosen people? Are we
and there's horrible responsibility with it.
Are we taking our responsibility seriously? It's natural for human beings to be friends with those who have something to offer them. What about being friends with those who have nothing to offer you, but in fact need something from you? Think of the privileges that Seventh-day Adventists have been given in our day. The Sabbath, the writings of Ellen White, our prophetess, and an understanding of the great controversy that helps us to make sense of all of Scripture. If you haven't really dug into that and realized what an incredible privilege that is, you need to do so. Mm. Are we so excited about these privileges that we're prepared to tell the world? Do we know the truth about God so clearly that we can support it from Scripture so and we can explain it to those around us, this truth about God and His dealing with sinners?
And to help with that objective, can you tell them about our website?
Yes, our website is entitled, or named Theox, theox.org, and there's a lot of materials in there that talk about this very subject. In Amos 1-4, does he seem to be judgmental? Do we know how to speak out against wrong behavior without being judgmental? What about that in our day? I mean, we live in a world that's so politically correct that you're not supposed to condemn anybody for anything, right?
Correct.
How do you speak out against wrong without being judgmental?
It's too late. I'll do it again.
Next week.
Next week. You want another time.
Yeah.
Matthew 24, verse 14 says, the gospel is supposed to be given to the whole world. And that responsibility has been given to all of us. What are we doing about that responsibility? Why does God reveal such prophecies as the prophecy of Amos and the prophecy of Obadiah to us? Is it just to make an afternoon's reading, some entertainment? Or does God intend for us to learn something from such prophecies? And God says, when the prophecy happens, look at it, learn something. So what parallels are we supposed to see between our situation today and the situation of Amos and the situation of Obadiah?
Replay.
Look at Amos, what?
It's a replay.
Yeah. Look at Amos 4. Yoli was wanting us to look at Amos 4. We'll look at more at Amos 4 later, but read Amos 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 to go with it. And we'll talk about that next week. Thank you.